Good afternoon, everyone. We just wanted to briefly respond to the governor. I did receive the letter, and I think we may speak about it as well, as I'm understanding what the governor said. I guess it strikes me, again, a little disappointed. The governor is talking about compromise, and this is an interesting part of his letter. So, my compromise offers have included tax revenues, raising the income tax for the wealthy Minnesotans, raising cigarette tax, but I remain open to discussing those options with you. The governor continues to believe that the discussion needs to be about where the revenue comes from and how much. There's no compromise in the area that we're concerned about, and that's about raising and spending and reforming the way we are spending. Those were discussions that we got very close to in the June 29th and June 30th discussions with the governor. And since then, he's gone backwards, and it's all about who we're taxing and what's that rate of taxation. But we firmly believe the discussion needs to be about where are you spending the money, how are you spending the money, and most importantly, in what way are you spending the money differently that will result in savings and a more sustainable, cost-effective budget going forward. We all know that this is a difficult budget year, obviously. We've got a new House, a new Senate, and a new governor, and this has been very difficult discussions. But the compromise is just not about who are you taxing and how much are you taxing. We have to have the discussion of what are you spending your money on, and how does it differ from what we're doing, and in what way is it more sustainable going forward? That's the important compromise discussion that we need to hear, and we're not hearing that from the government. I understand that he's going on a car, driving around the state the next couple days. What I want to ask is that, Governor, before you get in your car and head to St. Cloud and have an important discussion with people in Minnesota, and that's fine, call us back tonight. But get a lights on, them. You know, at least in recent history, I understand there's some discussion, but at least in recent history, the longest shutdown in U.S. history. And so, Governor, call us back tonight. Let's pass the lights on bill. Let's get road construction back up and running. Let's make sure that boilers are being inspected, that the businesses can continue. Let's get the parks open. Let's get the rest stops open. Let's get Minnesota up and running. And if you want to continue this discussion, it's an important discussion. We believe in it. He believes it. But let's first start by getting Minnesota back and working.
And since the majority leaders said the governor plans on traveling tomorrow and going to some of our members' districts, if you might think, well, doesn't that take time away from what could be negotiating time here at the Capitol? And wouldn't the time be better spent here? But actually, I think that it's a good thing. He's hearing what our members are hearing when they've gone home and talked to the constituents, which is that 6% increase in the budget should be enough to get your job done and to be done. I think what our members have been hearing since the shutdown and even before the shutdown is that their constituents and the governor's constituents have neither the time nor the patience for the shutdown in these times. And that a lights on bill would end this immediately, would put more than 20,000 folks back to work, and then resolve our differences that we have and we need to resolve. But the broader discussion that the governor is asking for, I hope we will have, which is actually not going to be focused around how much more money can we get from taxpayers and through what means, but it will be how are we spending the very, very scarce dollars that are being put forward by the taxpayers in the state of Minnesota. So if that is the discussion, that is a good one. We hope that he does hear from that and that his trip is productive in that regard.
Well,
we continue to work at that. Look at it. Again, the governor's always been a little short of detail on his offers. As you said, we understand he wants to raise taxes, whatever it is, alcohol tax, cigarette tax, income tax, preferably, I think, is what he thinks is preference. We understand that. Governor, where do you want to spend it? And for us, the reforms are absolutely key. Because if the governor is looking for more money, then where are you spending it? And how are you spending it? In what ways can we reform it so that in the next years, that will be more that's the decision. Now, we continue to look at his numbers and we see what we can work with within that. But ultimately, it's still confusing. We'd like to cast lights on bill. We'd really like to go to work. As you all know, we have 6 bills that could be wrapped up very quickly. And we have some discussions on those, some more difficult discussions lay around the health and human services bill. Where you have double digit growth, it's not sustainable, some reforms are needed very desperately in that area. Secondly, it's around state government. We would just like to look at how state government works. Could it be streamlined? Could it be made more efficient? Could it be made more user friendly and save some dollars for them? And thirdly, the area of taxes and credits. Those are the 3 areas where the difficulty is. When it comes to public safety, when it comes to law enforcement, courts, K-12 education, colleges, the parks, those are areas where we have agreement. Let's get those bills passed. If we have to do with the lights on and then continue to finalize those bills and then work on the cover bills, we're not picky about the process. But those 6 bills to be wrapped up quickly. But we need to get on the cost back. So we're going to continue to ask
this. Jeff, question asked if you're prepared. Is that in the works?
We continue to work on that, Rachel. In the meantime, we would, we can start an offer for, I don't know if you want to say this is a standing offer, but really is. We could come back to that and pass the lights on bill.
Continuation to work, how long is that going to take? And isn't the way negotiations work is 5 minutes not for the other 7 minutes not for it, and you come to agreement?
Sure, and we'll keep working on that. But I think what's imperative is we've got to work, we're going to be working on that. But I think it's really important that the governor at this point calls us back, gets the lights on. We know that there are 6 bills that could be wrapped up very quickly. There are 3 bills that are more difficult because those conversations that we have to have if we're going to be sustainable. We're really focusing our efforts on those 3 areas. That's the area where we felt like, especially in health and human services, we were making some progress, but those folks need to continue to work because if the governor is going to be expanding the number of the folks on the list, then we want to do it in a way that's more responsible. That's the reform that we need to get. So we need to get a signal from the governor that he's willing to accept some reforms in exchange for expanding that eligibility. We've continued discussions. That's not something where you're going to be able to, set something out. But we can set out some parameters, we can agree to those, and then they will need to go to work and continue and finalize these plans.
But specifically,
that
compromise on raising spending is important to the government. I mean, that will you bring out for that specifically raising spending?
Those are always part of this discussion. I mean, our original bills were all about raising spending, and most importantly, the reforms. Absolutely, that's always an important part of our discussion together. And any offer that we've made is the reform discussion is that part of that.
Can we make this kind of an offer to the government?
You're not sure what you're going to do. Well, I think that we saw some of our offers that there were some specific discussions. The governor knows and understands where we might consider where we could work with him in the area of reform and raising spending, and we could work with him in the area of some of the things that he needs, whether it's early on and just that sort of thing. But first of all, foremost, we'd like to have lights on. We'd like the governor to call us back, get some lights on, and then continue that difficult discussion on HHS. Wrap up the other 6 bills, we can get those done, wrap them up, we can wrap those up by Wednesday and pass those bills.
The Republicans only have what they have made at this point as an offer. Are you going to come up with any other offer anytime today, tomorrow, the next day?
Well, we put the lights on an idea. There's an additional conflict here. Without a hard and fast deadline, it feels like this is just grinding. Another day, another day, another day. And the governor's not leaving the Capitol. So our suggestion on the lights on is not just to turn back the state on them. That's important. We want to do that. You can also use the lights on to create some urgency and to set up a new deadline. You can put the lights on for a month. Yesterday, Tim Penny and Tom Horn, or excuse me, 2 days ago in your paper, suggested a 60-day lights on. In order to kind of set aside some time and a framework for discussions on the budget and on more of the but to just put Minnesota back to work and not hold these, all these programs and all these services and 22,000 employees captive. So I think the lights on can actually help us procedurally as well as be really important to get the state going. And it's tough on Minnesota. There was some good progress made within those offices. There was those six bills that came up with that. There's been some good work on the HHS side. So I wouldn't say we're stepping back from the progress and the good work that's been done, but we've never looked at this as some kind of a used car negotiation. You go. We need to put together a good budget in really tough economic times. And we want to keep our focus on jobs.
We didn't take them off the table, Rachel. Oh, I'm sorry. The governor rejected our offer. And so, as far as we're concerned, when helping administrative assistants took up discussions again, they started from the same place. They started from the same place that they left off on June 30th. When K-12 picked up, we didn't start over. We didn't take back. We met the governor dollar for dollar on K-12. We didn't remove that from the table. In fact, we had those discussions going forward, starting from that place. Saying, all right, Governor, we met you dollar for dollar on your number then, but here's the reform of the K-12 that we'd like to see. So we decided we cannot remove those offers from the table. The Governor has rejected them in bits and pieces, but our discussions go forward. Any discussions that we're able to have with the Governor, and I'd like to meet with him today, those discussions remain a part of what we discussed with the Governor. I'll meet with him today. I can't speak to the Democrats. I was struck as well. I was watching some of the Sunday talk show. I was struck that the senators, the U.S. senators, were striking a similar note to what we're talking about. I just think it is the conversation that the U.S., that Minnesota, that got to have. So that I don't know about if the Democrats have the common color, but I know that for Republicans, we don't. It's just our concern is. I just heard today a number that said that the federal government has not paid principal since 1971. I want to check that, but that's striking. And so I think people look at that kind of spending, they look at the growth in government, and they're extremely concerned. And then you put that against the backdrop of a difficult recession where Minnesota families are, hours are being cut, wages are being lowered, or people are losing their jobs. The houses are underwater. All the while, gas prices, food prices are going up. And then they look to government and see that our budget has the largest state budget in Minnesota history. We have a 6% increase in our budget, even if you count in the federal stimulus dollars. And I think Minnesotans look at that and say, that should be enough. And never mind what's happening at the federal level, but certainly has echoed. Certainly not coordinated at all, but I just think it's the national conversation that's going to rise out of what people see as out of control government spending at the federal level or the state level, and the need to reduce rating of reform on our spending.
To what extent are you in conversation with the state party? With Tony Sutton, with Michael Brockwell, obviously. To what extent are they involved in these ideas that they're calling the
That's not active, although my to make sure we get to the press conference sometime. So obviously, we had conversations with Michael, haven't spoken to Tony, and I'm not even certain when. The discussions that I have about the budget are with the guy standing next to me, with the speaker, or with my members. And their conversations and their strategy comes from their constituents.
And I can just follow up on that from our folks that have gone home, and they are in their communities. They are hearing a very, very clear message. And that is one that is very different from what we're hearing from the governor. What the governor is saying is that the only way to talk about negotiation is how much more money we're going to tax and who are we going to get it from. That if we're going to set that up as the only frame of our negotiations, that's not where it's going to get us very far, because that hasn't obviously gotten us very far thus far. But if he is going out and he is talking to folks across the state of Minnesota, as our members are, and as they are reporting back, he's going to have a far different message than he hears from them, which is, it's about the spending. It is not about how much more money you can raise in taxes and other revenues and where they're going to get it from. And it's very clear, and if that mirrors what's going on at the federal level, they're probably getting it from the same folks we are.
I think there's a stark difference that I see between what's happening, what the president is doing, and what the government is doing. You know, because there's President Obama is really empowered his vice president. Vice President Biden was trying to do that for, I think, weeks, if not months, to look at budget options and spending reductions. I think the president empowers his staff a little more than his governor does. So, we would love to see Lieutenant Governor Trevor Stone get involved in these discussions. We would love to see more empowered commissioners. And when we have an empowered ag commissioner, we finished an ag budget thing. So I think some of the messages and some of the conflict seems to stand come out of D.C., but if you don't want to keep an eye on kind of the process and the spend difference that's going forward.
As you all know, formerly Senator Trevor Stone, so he's got a really great working knowledge of the Minnesota Senate, and you know, going to be familiarity with the Minnesota House. But you know, I just think that I think folks see her as a colleague, someone we work with. I think she has a real understanding of it. The idea is we need 34 votes in the Senate and we need 68 votes in the House. And we've been saying that, and of course the governor understands that, but it comes from a different angle. There is Senate Representative Stone comes, you know, from a very recently from the Minnesota Senate and from the legislature. And so, and it never hurts to have, you know, folks a new voice that's well versed in the budget come in and share that conversation. The conversation, should be helpful in the conversation. I'd like to wrap it up tonight. Tom, I'd like this to not go on one day longer. I'd like to have road construction going tomorrow. I'd like to see the parks open tomorrow. I'd like to get the lights on at least tonight. I'd like to continue working, wrap up those six bills and finish them, and you know, continue discussions on the final three. But I'm not ready to let this go on. I'd like to end this tonight.
You could end this tonight. I agree with Governor Davis, just like you could end the tonight. I agree with you.
But we're not even suggesting that the governor agrees. So we're saying, let's get lights on for tonight and continue the discussions. The discussions have to be not just around, you know, who you're going to tax and how much, but about reforms and reductions. We're not seeing that in the office from the governor.
We also have to have bills that we can pass that add up. I mean, you just look at K-12 and the HHS bill. The bills with reform and with lots of spending. We can't pass press releases, we can't pass letters, we can't pass YouTube videos on the internet that are more probably created and more well suited for an election than actually getting our work done and getting out of here. We have to pass legislation. We have to get those 34 votes that we need to do that. We haven't seen that the numbers don't add up in the legislation and the people don't come together on it. So there has to be a very sudden exception of reality, I think, into these discussions immediately.
get to the next step, and hopefully that's what we're going to have. And with more voices that come in from around the state, hopefully we will see them come forward with bills. But we are very close on many, many areas and many bills that can pass very quickly. We have some distance in other areas. But what folks are telling us is resolving differences where you can and where you can move forward with the lights on.
Invited you back to talks today. I think we're asking the same question, actually.
Yeah, I haven't heard from the governor. Obviously, we're willing to meet with him anytime, any place. And he has always been the same, but we could just, he is the governor of the state, and he's got other schedules. But we're here and available all day, today, tomorrow.
It's not far from the attorney general. The priority meeting was the best of our
And we absolutely could don't. What we would do, we continue discussions on many levels with the government. I think that what we're looking for from the government is a discussion that's not a YouTube video, not a press release, not a letter, but the governor is reaching out to us and not just talking about it. If he's looking for $1.4 billion in new taxes, but that's not an area of compromise. If he's talking about additional reductions and reforms, and then what he might seek from us, if that's the discussion that he's willing to have, then we're happy to have it. But that needs to be part of the discussion, not a letter just outlining the more possible tax increases.
Why do you have a meeting to solve that here? Why are you telling us to
we're happy to do that. Maybe I'll just give them a call when we're done here and let them know. I hope that would help. We've had the discussion over and over with the governor, especially when we were getting very close at the end. We made it very clear to the governor that the reforms are a big piece of this. It's not about who we're taxing and how much, but what do you want the money for? And since then, the offerings or the letters from the governor have revolved solely around what kind of taxes and how much.
Let's not go and disagree since the campaign, we disagree in January, disagree in the summer. What's going to magically happen in 60 days or whatever to do a lights on
bill? Well, if our preference would not be just the lights on bill time, we'd like to test the six bills and get the six bills passed where we have agreement. We have the ag bill passed. The six others will pass quickly. We're willing to do just the lights on bill because we don't disagree in the process. But my true brothers, if you will, would be to go in, pass temporary funding, pass the six bills where we're close, get that progress, get that win under our belt. Someone interviewed a mediator. I don't know which panel it was, but they interviewed a mediator and they commented on getting some of those bills passed. And that we've been saying all along, if you could work on individual bills and get some progress there, it probably would help clarify the remaining bills. And I think that it would. And so that would be my preference. My preference would not be just lights on at the 60 days. My preference would be lights on and going to work and start casting the bills where we're close, working out, continuing discussions on the bills where we're looking for their preference.
Lights on would be particularly important at this point because you're creating a disadvantage, but then you have those bills, but then it becomes, say, suggested that it's actually increasing. Can you see from this point of view?
Well, I can tell you that there are physicians with patients who are lined up with you who can't see those patients because they don't have a medical license in the state of Minnesota because they're waiting on a shutdown. There's elevator inspectors that can't get to work. There's my neighbor who works for transportation who's out of work. It would be a big difference to those people who could immediately go back to work. And it would also be a step forward for other people in other states looking at Minnesota to say, what's going on in Minnesota? Why don't they have their act together? That maybe we're getting our act together. And that we can resolve these differences, and we must resolve these differences, but we shouldn't do so by punishing the good, hardworking folks in the state of Minnesota, the people who rely on their services.
One part of the political language is getting those Minnesotans to take them back working. We're the ones that are willing to go back in. If we could, I'd call the Senate back in tomorrow and pass that lights on bill. I heard another story about the steel toe brewery and they're not able to begin brewing their beer. They have a boiler that needs to be inspected. Now, the Department of Labor, that's under your purview, is largely fee-based and federal money-based. There's very, very little genocide money. So steel-toe brewery and the like are being held up. Even though they're money-based, they're based on fees, they're based on federal money, money that is not in dispute here. So let's get that backward. Labor wanted to get brewing last week. And that's the kind of difference that the Lights Out Bill would have, and we're very happy to bring that to the floor of the Senate, pass that, and then continue to work.
Well, absolutely. We were not able to come together, and nobody feels good about that. But on the same token, the fact that it should have been avoided, 100% should have been avoided. It was preventable. And I'm very proud of the work that the legislators did in the House and the Senate, putting together great reform bills, put him on his desk, put him online, tried to accommodate his request to allow maximum input from him and the outside. I'm very proud of the bills that we passed and with the work that the legislature did. Unfortunately, they were vetoed the day after the legislature adjourned, and that put us into the trajectory where we now find ourselves. And it is not a good position to be in, but we can and should call, the governor can and should call us back to at least get the state employees working again. Thank you.